Hey there, and welcome to episode 15 of the Halfway Through the Heat podcast, the world's most important trans-Pacific podcast. And this week, we are going to be talking about, of course, some news, but we'll also be talking about some indie shows we went to over the weekend, wrestling and politics, including some wrestlers who became politicians and politicians who are interested in wrestling, and the promoter of the year. But also, of course, something positive about Raw. So I am here today, joined with, of course, my co-host, Tom. Tom, start us off with your positive thing about Raw.
Well, I know we are an island of positivity in a sea of negativity, but this was a tough one. This week was a little hard to find something positive to say about Raw, so it's more of a victory snatch from the jaws of defeat. Big Show wrestled Mark Henry, and I didn't see it.
That's it. That's positive.
That's my positive thing about Raw. I missed that one.
Unfortunately, that can't be my positive because I saw that.
Oh God.
And it wasn't as horrible as you'd imagine because it was like half a minute.
Right.
So
yeah.
You know, I guess that's a positive. It was only like it was really short. But actually, I have something positive about Raw that was really quick. It was the first thing that happened. The U.S. Championship Open Challenge came back.
Oh, yeah, that's right. That is positive.
Now, I can't say the match that happened was positive because it kind of devolved into a six-man tag team match after like a minute or two. But the concept of that, the six-man, the Open Challenge is back is good because that was really entertaining. And it was, you know, like, go back and listen to the previous podcast. You'll see that the Open Challenge was one of the highlights of Raw. One of the easily the positive things we could pick out about Raw. So hopefully they will continue to be positive in the future.
That's really it in terms of positivity about Raw. But we have other stuff to talk about this week.
Yeah, because if we were relying on positivity about Raw, we would be done. But we do have a lot of things to talk about, and this time it's not a lot of news. We actually don't have a lot of news to talk about.
Whoa. As everyone knows, it's Bound for Glory season.
Bound for Glory season, the big season of the year, where everybody's looking forward to all those matches with whatever's happening at Bound for Glory.
Well, okay. So it's the biggest night in sports entertainment involving a company called Bound for Glory or TNA, and it's happening Sunday, this coming Sunday, October 4th, at the Cabarrus Arena in Concord, North Carolina, not in Charlotte, North Carolina, despite what the company is saying. And they've announced, I think, most of the matches, and you know. Let's just run that down real quickly, see what we've got to look forward to. Tigre Uno versus Rockstar Spud versus DJZ versus Manic in a four-way match for the X Division Championship. That could be good.
Yeah, it could be good. But the thing with it is that TNA has been really bad with the X Division recently. It's been not exciting to watch. And usually it is, which is like they're screwing it up more than normal.
The Wolves, Davey Richards and Eddie Edwards, will be wrestling Brian Myers and Trevor Lee for the TNA World Tag Team Championship, and that also could be a good match.
I'd expect it to be good because the Wolves are in there, so okay. I'll give you that.
I saw two of those guys. I saw Eddie Edwards and Trevor Lee over the weekend, but we'll talk about that later. I actually am sort of excited for this match. Gail Kim versus Awesome Kong. This is one of the legitimate TNA created rivalries in the history of TNA, Gail Kim and Awesome Kong. And I'm glad they're wrestling one more time for the championship. These two have sort of divergent styles, but they always have a good match together because there seems to be sort of genuine animosity between them. Whether that's true or not, they do a great job of conveying it. So that could be a good match.
It might be good. I think I think both of them should be in the WWE again.
No, I agree.
But, you know, not going to happen.
No. We have a TNA World Heavyweight Championship match with Jeff Hardy as the special guest referee. Ethan Carter III versus Drew Galloway. That could be good. Drew Galloway is really good.
Yeah, you know, I think, like, I like Ethan Carter III. I think he's a pretty good wrestler, and I think he's, like, a good kind of character in the in TNA. He's, like, one of the few bright spots that I see. But, like, you know, there are a few people that I like in TNA. Like, I like Rockstar Spud a lot, too, but he always loses.
Right.
And, you know, I like EC3, but, you know, again, he's in TNA. So he's kind of wasted there.
We also have the hot mess of a gauntlet match. The winner will get a future TNA World Heavyweight Championship match, which is interesting. The idea that there will be a future. The gauntlet match is just this huge, like, it's Abyss and Tyrus and Mr. Anderson and Jesse Godders and Robbie E and Eli Drake and Chris Melendez. And I mean, there's like 10 guys in this thing. I don't even know what a gauntlet match is, but it sounds stupid.
Who do you pick as the winner of that? Now, keep in mind that Kurt Angle has already said he's leaving the company. So he has to, there's no way that Kurt Angle will be fighting for the championship. So whoever is going to be fighting for the championship here is possibly the winner. Mr. Anderson, you'd say?
Mr. Anderson, maybe? I don't, like, it's so hard to, like, guess TNA booking decisions.
Yeah.
And then there's a King of the Mountain Championship, which apparently is also a championship, and Bobby Roode. And Lashley will be going head-to-head for that. That could be good. I think that's the end of a Global Force wrestling angle.
It probably is, because that King of the Mountain title is in there, that Jeff Jarrett was the...
Right. Now I think Bobby Roode has it. You can tell our engagement with the TNA product from how enthusiastic we are about Bound for Glory Week. Also, as you alluded to, there's a special Please Don't Die match involving Kurt Angle and Eric Young. Is that right?
Yes. This match seems really like a bad idea.
Mm-hmm.
It's in a cage with a Kurt Angle who has just come off of neck surgery like 3 weeks ago. And not that he had like surgery on his neck so much as it was like removing some kind of like growth or something on his neck, but whatever. It's 3 weeks ago. Dude had surgery on his neck and is now going to be in a steel cage match on a pay-per-view he's like, what, 46, 47?
Yeah.
It's essentially should be called the Please Don't Die match, because, there's just not really going to be a lot of, moments where you're going to be like, yeah, that was an awesome spot without appending. I'm glad Kurt Angle didn't die there.
Right. Like normally when people are chanting, please don't die, it's like, because, you know, Angelico is about to like jump off a balcony and plummet. This is going to be a please don't die match just because Kurt Angle is going to be in it.
Yeah, that's pretty much true. It's a little strange actually, that it's happening at all, just because, you know, it seems like, I mean, Kurt Angle, let's be honest, Kurt Angle is like a weird Superman where he can like totally rebound from things quickly, but
it's true.
You know, it's not like, you know, at 40, 46 or whatever, he is rebounding as quickly as he did when he was 36 or 30 or any of those earlier times when he was in WWE, for example.
Yeah, I mean, I like Kurt Angle a lot. I like Eric Young a lot. I mean, both these guys, under good circumstances, could have a tremendous wrestling match. But I just think, given Kurt Angle's age, his injuries, the fact that, as you pointed out, 3 weeks ago he was having neck surgery, it just seems to me that this is not a good idea. And if everything comes out okay, which we hope it will, that should probably be Kurt Angle's last wrestling match.
Yeah, you know, like, I don't even think that it should be his last match. I think he could probably do more, but, you know, where? It's not,
right.
I doubt the WWE is going to bring him back. Not that he's not a big name and like people would be happy to see him, but, you know, again, you're always going to be like, is Kurt Angle going to get hurt horribly?
Yeah, there have been rumors that they've wanted to bring him back in a non-wrestling role, but that he's shot that down. Which, you know, from everything I've heard about the guy makes sense. You know, he's a great athlete, like legitimately like a gold medal winner in the Olympics, like, you know, a world-class athlete, and, you know, probably wants to do this as long as he feels capable. But also from the WWE's perspective, with the specter of Owen Hart in the background, like, I understand why they don't want to have anyone die in a wrestling ring.
Yeah. And with Kurt Angle, he's, you know, he's got a legit neck injury that occurred to him where he was, like, you know, seriously sidelined for a long time. And, you know, that kind of thing is, I mean, not that I have, like, any inside information regarding Kurt Angle's health status, but, like,
right.
You know, that kind of, it's scary just to hear about, never mind, like,
yeah,
to have happened to you and still be doing the same stuff. But, you know, maybe he's fine. Maybe he really is like Kurt Angle, Superman. But, you know, it is kind of scary just like knowing his past history of injury.
Yeah, so that is that. I mean, that's bound for glory week. Oh no! Oh my God! How could I forget the thing that's going to draw all 5,500 people to the Cabarrus County Memorial Arena? It's going to be the induction of the TNA Hall of Fame of Earl Hebner.
Oh, how did you forget that?
How could I forget that? Maybe because I was too excited.
I really wonder why TNA has a Hall of Fame. Like, there's how many people are in it? There's like 10. Maybe
it's not even, I don't think it's that. I think it's like 8 or 9, maybe less,
but
it is all like former WCW and WWF people. It's terrible.
Yeah. It's the kind of thing where like, there's almost no point in having a Hall of Fame where you have 7 people or whatever. It's not a Hall of Fame then. It's just, you know, like usually when people open a Hall of Fame, they automatically put in like a bunch of people just to make it a thing. You know, you put up all the classics in there. So, you know, that like something that everybody would agree is a person who belongs in the Hall of Fame. Maybe they're all dead, whatever. I'm sure that when the Baseball Hall of Fame opened, they didn't like not include Babe Ruth and like slowly over the course of years added him later.
Right.
You know, yeah, even the Wrestling Hall of Fame we went to in New York is, you know, it's chock full of people, but you know, I'm sure they didn't add those all one at a time.
No, they have like, yeah, classes of, you know, 5 or 6 people, whatever it is, per year, which is what all Hall of Fames do. Even the Wrestling Observer Newsletter Hall of Fame. And also, I know this is a thing that wrestling nerd fans like to get worked up about, but like if and this goes for TNA too, if there's not actually a physical place where you can go, you don't have a Hall of Fame. You have a web page of fame.
Yeah, I mean, that's true. I think WWE doesn't have a place either, do they?
No, they don't. So, I mean, like, to me, you know, when people are like, oh, man, is Hulk Hogan no longer in the WWE Hall of Fame? There's no Hall of Fame. Like, Hulk Hogan's been taken down from a website.
Yeah, that's essentially it. I mean, it's not a huge deal. But, you know, it's because there isn't really a place. You can't go to Titan Towers and see the WWE Hall of Fame. There's nothing.
No.
No,
it's more like getting a Lifetime Achievement Award, but they don't want to call it WWE Lifetime Achievement Award winners, so they call it the Hall of Fame.
Yeah, whereas there are legit halls of fame, I guess, in various parts of the country that are, I guess, competing. I don't really know.
It's weird to think that, but yeah, we went to the one in New York. I know there's one in Allentown, Pennsylvania. There's one in St. Louis. There's one in Iowa. So they all kind of like work their own niche. But, you know, at least the thing is, like, at least they have a building you can go to and like see the plaques of the, I mean, the one in New York was really impressive, as we talked about in the podcast. And like the TNA Hall of Fame, as you point out, not only does not have a physical place you can go to, there's like 7 people.
Yeah, even if there was a place you could go to, you wouldn't want to go because it would be a waste of time. You'd be like, well, I just saw 7 pictures and plaques.
Yeah, like who would even, I mean, yeah.
Yeah.
So it's oh my God, it's worse than that. So it's Sting, Kurt Angle, Jeff Jarrett, Earl Hebner, and the Dudley Boys. So that's 1, 2, 3, 4, 6. And one of them is a tag team.
That's horrible.
And none of them are like TNA made stars.
Yeah, zero.
Oh my God. And Earl Hebner is going to be inducted by Billy Corgan. If I lived as I used to, if I lived near Concord, North Carolina, I would definitely go to this. But I'm actually going to a WWE house show on Sunday, which we can talk about later. So that's Bound for Glory week that we're clearly celebrating in high style here. The only other news, it's sort of called the minor crime news. One, because I thought it was kind of funny. But the other one, as people may know, is that Hornswoggle, he's the little person in the WWE who got his start as Fit Finley's sidekick, a leprechaun named Little Bastard.
That's a classic Attitude Era.
I know. Yeah, God. He's been suspended for 30 days for an unspecified violation of the wellness policy. But the fact that it's only 30 days suggests it might have been a little bit of the wacky tobacco or similar recreational substance.
The thing that surprised me the most about this story was that Hornswoggle was still employed by WWE.
Yeah, it's been a while since I've seen Hornswoggle on WWE TV. I think his last run was sometime last year with a three-man band. And almost all those guys except Heath Slater are gone too. So yeah, it's been, but who, I mean, he's also starred in their Leprechaun franchise installment.
The Leprechaun. I have not seen that Leprechaun, but I have seen all the other Leprechaun movies, which probably says way more about me than I was willing to admit. But, I've seen all the Leprechaun in the Hood movies. I've seen all the regular Leprechaun movies, but I haven't seen this one yet because I didn't know it existed.
Hornswoggle he's no Warwick Davis. I'm just going to leave it there.
Oh. When I saw that article, I was surprised to see that he was the Leprechaun. I was like, did Warwick Davis give up on the Leprechaun series?
Like, that's pretty bad when, like, Warwick Davis passes on a script. He's like, you know what? We've scraped the barrel enough. There's just no more juice left in the Leprechaun franchise. When Warwick Davis says that, WWE's like, you know what? Fine. We have a little person. His name's Hornswoggle.
Perfect.
If you do see it, and I've seen it, it's a group of annoying young Americans who go backpacking in Ireland, but like the quote unquote Ireland, it's like clearly Georgia. It looks nothing like Ireland. And they get attacked by a murderous leprechaun. But yeah, so anyway, he's suspended for something, some wellness policy violation. We hope you're back doing whatever it was you were doing before, Hornswoggle. And the other minor crime news, I just thought this was funny. The Undertaker, his house, Undertaker, of course, is married to former WWE diva Michelle McCool. They went to like a charity marathon over the weekend and somebody came and like toilet papered their house, TP'd their house, as it were. And they did like a really shitty job. You can see Michelle McCool posted pictures on Twitter about it. No pun intended. But I just like imagining that it was Paul Heyman and Brock Lesnar.
They should work that into an angle. Like,
they really should. Like, there's like grainy security camera footage of like Heyman in his suit throwing rolls of toilet paper over trees at the Undertaker's house.
They should just make that for for hilarity. Like, just,
they should.
It would be really good if they were just, I mean, it would kill this stupid feud that they have, but like,
but that feud needs to die anyway.
Yeah, I mean, apparently it'll die next month when Undertaker probably dies.
Yeah, God, I didn't want to think about it.
Speaking of Please Don't Die matches.
Another Please Don't Die match. Yeah, but this one is going to be like, even because like his last two big matches, The Undertaker has like gone to the hospital. Like, it's just not, and this isn't a cage. I don't like this idea. But the other good thing about it too is that you saw pictures on Twitter that Michelle McCool posted. Undertaker has a really nice house. So it's good to know that at least one wrestler like saved his money and, you know, didn't spend it all on unwise pursuits.
Or he just blew it all in a big house. You didn't think of that, did you, Tom?
That's better than whatever, I'm not going to say anything, but whatever Jake Roberts spent his money on, which was not a house.
Okay. That's legit.
So anyway, yeah, good luck finding the Vandals Undertaker, unless it's Paul Heyman and Brock Lesnar. So that's it for news. And before we move on to general topics, we both have I guess what in the old, the punk rock days would be called show reviews. We both went to see some wrestling over the weekend. You in Tokyo and me in Providence, Rhode Island.
Yeah. So, tell us about your Providence, Rhode Island show. This is another Beyond Wrestling show.
Yes, this is the promotion Beyond Wrestling, which is getting something of a reputation as kind of an East Coast pro wrestling gorilla. And this show, they actually had two shows on the weekend, one on Saturday, what I went to, and they had a show in Boston on Sunday, and I guess they sold that show out, so congratulations to them. They're a great promotion. The show I saw was, though, notable because it was Biff Busick's last indie show, at least, you know, for the foreseeable future. Biff Busick is going to NXT along with Rich Swann and Athena and a new class of indie standouts. And so Biff Busick, this was kind of like a tribute to him. It was a round robin format where Biff Busick, Drew Gulak, Timothy Thatcher, and Eddie Edwards all wrestled each other. And so, I mean, like, those are four really, really talented guys, and they have very complimentary styles. It was just great to watch. I mean, it was especially the first match, Busick and Gulak was like, I mean, it could have been a wrestling match in like 1948. It was so old school, and they did it so well. And the crowd was so, I mean, this was a really hot crowd. The crowd was so into it that like people were cheering for like, you know, side headlock takeovers. Like just, it was like Luthez and Vern Gagne. I mean, it was that old, and those guys, that's kind of their style. So it was great, but the show also had Ricochet, who I saw in person for the first time, which was delightful. He wrestled JT Dunn in a fantastic match.
Did he do some kind of 1280 flip off the top rope onto the floor?
No, it was really, I think he was saving that because he was headlining the Sunday Night Show in Boston, and he wrestled Shinron, another high flyer. So apparently that match was just unbelievable. So I think he was kind of like keeping some of it in reserve on Saturday night, but it was still great because he's so good at everything. He doesn't, like, there's no wasted movements. Like, he moves so gracefully and does everything so well. It was just phenomenal to watch. And JT Dunn is an up and comer who's very good. So there was also some other good matches. There was a tag match, Team Tremendous against Andrew Everett and Trevor Lee. That was like started out as a comedy match and then like turned into this crazy spot fest where like they just kept doing all these insane dives into the crowd. And the thing about Beyond Wrestling is that there are no seats, so everyone comes right up to the ring. And so like you've got to move out of the way pretty quickly when guys are jumping into the crowd, especially like Bill Carr from Team Tremendous, who's very agile and is like 300 pounds. But it was great because my friends and I went with two guys, Mark and Mike, and we were like right up at the ring. So, like, I mean, literally, like, hands on the ring, which is a really cool way to see a wrestling show. And then, finally, the last match was Biff Busick and Eddie Edwards. And they had a great, great match. I mean, just both those guys just, you know, gave everything they had. And the crowd was completely nuts for Busick, singing his theme song even after the music cut out. And the promoter, Drew Cordero, was just like bawling his eyes out, just like crying and crying and crying. It was very emotional. And then at the end, Busick like crowd surfed around the building, and so did Drew Cordero, actually, while his song was playing. So it felt really nice. It was kind of like almost like graduation. Like everybody was really happy for him. There were only like a few weak chants of NXT sucks. Mostly people were just super happy that this guy who's a really good wrestler is going to get a chance to make it on a bigger stage. Who knows what's going to happen? You know, I think that about all the indie talents who go to NXT, like you can't tell if they're going to be more Kevin Owens or more, Sami Callihan, but, I'm cautiously optimistic and I had a great time. This was maybe the best wrestling show I've been to just in terms of like feeling a part of it because the crowd was like hot from start to finish. It's sort of a unique atmosphere when you're that close to the action. So it was a great show, but you also had an excellent time, as I understand.
Yes, I went to a DDTPro show, and I talked about DDTPro a bit last week, but it's kind of like a goofy sports entertainment kind of Japanese wrestling, and there were a lot of kind of jokey spots and kind of comedy matches. But they're all really fun. So, you know, a lot of the matches, they're kind of like sort of serious, but then they'll do like a goofy comedy spot or something, or like
Right.
they'll have a comedy match where like it's played serious at first and then it turns into a comedy match, but like in a kind of goofy way. But like, you know, to give you an idea, the show's of course started out with the King of Dark Match Championship, which is, you know, a kind of DDT Pro thing where they give, it's like the Biggest Loser belt. So if you lose the match, you keep the belt because you're the King of Dark Match. You don't even get a you don't get a match on the actual show. You're actually the match, and like the gimmick with this match is that it actually starts before the official start time of the show.
I love
So
that.
it's the first match. Oh, it's always the first match, and it actually, like, the doors open at 11, the show started at 12, this match started at 11:30. Like, the King of Dark Match match. And like the guy who was the King of Dark Match is this guy, Gota Ihashiu, is like a huge fat guy. Like, not like he has a gigantic round stomach. Like, it's really goofy looking. And like, you know, he's kind of a he's a heel also. And it was funny because you know how like they did a spot where like they were doing chops back and forth. You know, the crowd like does the woo yeah thing. But for him, it was like they would do the woo, and then when he would do it, people would make a pig noise. So he would make the pig noise when he made the when he did the when he did his chops, which was funny. But he, you know, being a huge fat guy, he also did a moonsault twice.
Wow.
And like it was, you know, it was kind of impressive considering how big he was. And like so that was the King of Dark Match thing. And then like they had this kind of thing where one of the guys is like they played like a little backstage clip thing, you know, like a skit before the match on the screen that was at the event. And like the guy is like talking about how he's like he's not going to take any of like the person he's fighting is this guy who comes out with like flashing glasses with lights in him that flash and stuff, and he like does dances and stuff, and he's kind of a goofball. And he was like, you know, doing a promo, cut a promo on him, like, I'm not gonna be all goofy and not gonna take any of your crap or whatever. And then like that guy is he's like all serious, like, yeah, okay, I get it. And then like he the guy leaves and he's like giggling to himself, like he's planned something. And then like later on they play the next skit where the guy is like in the locker room like changing to get ready to, for the match, and all his ring gear has been stolen, and he's left with this, you know, gigantic pink pants and leggings and a peach shaped hat that goes over his entire head shaped like a peach. So like he's like all played all serious at the beginning, and he has to come out in this like peach cape. He has a cape, and like on the back of his shorts that are like way oversized, it says peach, and he's wearing a peach shaped hat. And like, you know, they have their match, and like he's constantly like he'll, you know, halfway through the match, he like took off the peach thing and threw it at him, and the guy was on the top rope, and it bounced off and made him fall. And then like, you know, like he took it off like he's mad, like he's wearing the stupid peach hat, and then he went and picked it up and put it back on. So then, so like there was lots of stuff like that where it's kind of goofy, and he's like trying to play it serious, like he's being forced to wear the peach boy outfit. So it was goofy. There's lots of stuff like that. And then like there's a part in the match where the finish is actually this thing where they did a dance number together because the guy who he's facing has like this thing where he dances, and like he, you know, puts on the glasses and he takes somebody's glasses from the audience and puts it on that guy, and they did like a dance number together. And then like the guy in the peach uniform at the end of the dance number just like did a schoolboy and pinned him. But it was really fun. Like it was such a goofy thing that it was like totally the feel of a DDT Pro show where it's like this kind of goofy thing happens. And like at the same time, the wrestling was good. So like you don't feel really bad. Like it's like just kind of a goofy thing that happened. And then there was like, of course, Joey Ryan was there in it wrestling in a tag match. And this was really good too, because Joey Ryan was really over with the crowd. Like they loved Joey Ryan. And, you know, he came out and, you know, you'd think like the team where like his partner is a Japanese guy, but he came out with a huge American flag and all of his ring gear is like American flag patterned. So like, this is the Japanese guy and his hair is dyed blonde and he's like carrying a American flag and he got, but like hilariously, they got the crowd of entirely Japanese people like to do a USA chant. So there was like multiple USA chants throughout this match in Japan by entirely Japanese people.
One of those right wing political parties with a sound truck is going to be upset about that.
But yeah, it was a really fun match, and of course Joey Ryan was way over, so you know, he did his spot with the blow pop in his shorts.
Yep.
And you know, he at the point they both pulled blow pops out of their trunks and tried to stick it in the mouths of the opposite team, and then the opposite team countered and stuck it in opposite person's mouths.
Yep.
So yep. There was that, and then there was the eventually Joey Ryan got the win with the sweet tooth music, which is putting the blow pop in the mouth and then following it up with a super kick.
I saw he retweeted one of your photos.
Yeah. Not only did he retweeted three of my tweets, but he also just straight up stole my photos and reposted them.
What?
Evening Joey Ryan. Yeah.
Evening Joey Ryan.
No, but I don't care. But yeah, they also did a really funny thing with Joey Ryan, because like afterwards, they were saying like, this is Joey Ryan's last match in Japan. And, his partner, came out and said like, they did this thing throughout the show actually, where at the end of the match, like they play this sentimental music and someone would come out and read a letter they wrote. And, again, this was like the third time it happened, I think, on the show, but Joey Ryan's partner was like, because you're leaving, I wrote you a letter. And he pulls a letter out of his trunks and like starts reading this like letter about Joey Ryan. And then Joey Ryan like you know, says a thing like cuts this promo like, oh yeah, I loved being in Japan and I'm gonna come back, so you know, don't worry about it, someday I'm gonna come back and you'll see me again. And everyone cheered and they left. And then like they in a total DDTPro thing that like they played another, you know, after the match was over, everybody was gone and they were like getting ready to start the next match, they like played a video of like, see, you know, like, you know, after now we've got a special announcement for a secret guest star that's coming back to DDT in November, and like it's, you know, like a black silhouette. And they are announcing it like it's this big thing. And then like the special guest star coming back in November is Joey Ryan. So like right after the match, Joey Ryan said like, I don't know when, but someday I'm going to come back. And then like not a minute later, they play a clip of like revealing Joey Ryan as this special guest coming back in November. It was really funny. Like, because it was all dramatic. Like it was going to be something big, like totally unrelated to the match because they had finished the match. Like everybody left. And then like, they played that and it was like just Joey Ryan again. It was really funny.
I love that. So you're going to see him in November, do you think?
Yeah, I'll probably go back because it was really good. Overall, the show was really good. Kota Ibushi was there in a tag match. And he, you know, he's in New Japan. He's like a super good wrestler. Does all these like awesome spots. Is like a great high flyer. And yeah, he was there, but like apparently he was sick recently. Like he must have had some kind of like flu or something, because he was like canceled off one or two shows, but he's back, so he wasn't injured so much as he was probably just sick. But like, and originally on this match he was supposed to be wrestling a singles match, but he was put in a tag match after they changed the card for him to be on a tag match. So he was probably like sick or something, but like he came out and they did this thing where he like brought out this bottle of orange looking liquid and he claimed it was his medicine that would power him up. So they were like drinking it throughout the match. But like the thing with it was like a goofy kind of comedy match where Ibushi was other team was constantly like beating up his partner. And then like Ibushi would come in to save him and he would like beat off the other team. And then he would start beating up his partner too. But like, you know, like he would be, the idea was that like, he was so crazy into just beating everybody up that he just would start beating up his partner too. And it just kept happening over and over throughout the match. Like they'd be double teaming him outside the ring and he'd come over for the save. And then like, he'd turn around and like kick his partner too. there was lots of that. It was a kind of a goofy match, but it was fun. Like all of the matches like had that same, most of the matches had that same kind of thing where like either they were straight up goofy or like they were, had a lot of kind of funny spots. And there was a lot of that, which was nice. I mean, it was like it wasn't really serious, but it was still like a good, you know, wrestling thing. There was like, there's like all these kind of goofy characters. There was the kind of six-man tag match, which involved like, a lot of really cool wrestling where like, they did some really good spots and they had like this kind of, you know, the person who's considered like the weak link on the team, like was in the ring, like for 90% of the match, just getting brutalized and like kept kicking out of all these crazy finishers and stuff. Like it was it was pretty cool. And then like, eventually he won it for them. It was like a pretty good thing altogether. And then like the final match was the KOD openweight title. And this match was like totally different from all the other ones in that like it was really like a straight match. There was no goofiness to it. It was like a straight, like strong style kind of, you know, serious match where you had the champion who is, Yukio Sakaguchi, who is the champion. He's the KOD openweight champion. He's like this, you know, got dyed blonde hair and tattoos and stuff. He looks all badass. And then like the Daisuke Sasaki is his, the person he fought. And they've been doing this thing in DDT where Daisuke Sasaki has been winning a ton of matches with his new finisher, the Vietnam Driver 2.
Okay.
And, you know, he's been beating a bunch of people. So that's why he's challenging for the title. And like, they built it up with like this kind of package of where, you know, he's saying he's going to win with the Vietnam Driver 2. And then, Sakaguchi is saying like, I've learned how to counter it. So you're not going to be able to get it off. And like, you know, they do that. And he does counter it during the match and eventually wins. But like, there were a lot of cool spots. And the coolest thing, I think, is like, again, Yukio Sakaguchi's finisher is not like an impressive one to see, but it's another one of those finishers that has like just a cool name. So you want to see it regardless if it looks stupid, you know, like, like the Shining Wizard is like not an impressive move. It's just like a running knee. And then even like, the Rainmaker, it's like a short clothesline. It's not, it's not an impressive move, but it's just kind of got a cool name. So you think like, oh, it's awesome. And, this one is, his finisher's name is the right knee of God.
That's a fantastic finisher.
And it's just like a jumping knee. It's not, it's not anything special, but it's just got a good name. So you like it.
Selling the sizzle. It's all in the marketing. That's why I think my favorite example of that is, Shattered Dreams.
Yeah, Shattered Dreams is perfect. That's a really good one because, like, it's just a kick to the crotch.
He just kicks you in the balls, but it's called Shattered Dreams.
Yeah. I mean, that's the kind of finisher that is really good, I think. Like, I know people like to see the flashy finishers. I like to see flashy finishers, but, like, I'm perfectly fine with a knee to the head if it's called a Shining Wizard.
Right, absolutely, yeah. Yeah, I mean, especially because it's not hard to believe a knee to the head would really hurt.
Yeah, so it's kind of good. I think like, and on like a totally non-entertainment, side of things, picking a finisher like that is a really smart move.
Oh, yeah.
Because if you're, you know, if you listen to anybody who has like a more intensive finisher, like even if it's not like a flashy finisher, it's just something where you have to take a bump to do it. Like, all those people are like, I really regret not having a sleeper hold as my finisher or whatever. You know, like,
seriously.
Hulk Hogan is an example of that, where he, you know, he's like literally lost inches from his height because of doing the leg drop so many times.
Yep.
Like, he had to have parts of his back fused together because of like all the times he like took the bump on the base of his spine or whatever.
Yeah, because like that guy, I mean, Hulk Hogan in his prime in wrestling was like 300 pounds or close to it. And he's like jumping up in the air and landing on his spine multiple times. I was watching an interview with Jay Briscoe, and Jay Briscoe used to do, one of his moves was a top rope leg drop. And he was saying like he wished he had never done that, because like that's the first thing he feels when he wakes up in the morning. You know, it's like, yeah. Or Mick Foley's already had to have a hip replaced because he was the elbow drop. So like you're taking a bump every time you do your finisher. Much better to do like a half crab or something.
Yeah, that I always thought like that's much more reasonable too, because like a submission finisher is, you know, something where you don't have to hurt yourself. And like the thing with it is like if you're gonna wrestle and you're gonna get older, it's gonna be harder for you, because like if you've ever seen Honky Tonk Man, you saw Honky Tonk Man wrestle. Yep. We saw Honky Tonk Man wrestle. And this was like 20 years ago, but like you can't, you know, he can't do the shake, rattle, and roll anymore.
No.
He just can't do it. Like when we saw him, he didn't take the bump for it. All he did was like swing his arms around and flip the guy over and make the guy take the bump, and he didn't.
Right.
Like that's how he has to do it now, because like he's just too old to take the bump. And like that's the kind of thing. Like, you know, you know, Hulk Hogan probably can't do the leg drop anymore.
No.
I mean,
no.
I think he could do it, and I think he would do it, but he shouldn't.
It'd be a terrible idea.
Yeah, he shouldn't do it.
Yeah.
But, you know, like, if you've ever heard anybody talk about Hulk Hogan, like, they're like, he looks constantly in pain when he moves, but, like, if he were to go out to the ring, he would just pretend like he wasn't in pain and try to be, like, even in that recent appearance, like last WrestleMania or whatever, he took a bump like you wouldn't have expected him to, but he did. And right. it probably hurt him like a son of a bitch, but there he was doing it.
Yeah, no, I mean, and submissions as finishers can also be like really nasty looking too. And I think sometimes people worry about that. They want something that looks impactful for a finisher, but Eddie Edwards finished, he beat Drew Gulak on Saturday night with a half crab, right? Which is like, well, whatever, it's a half crab. But with his other foot, he was like stomping on Gulak's head. Like, that's just such a nasty addition to it. And actually, like, he busted Gulak open. Gulak was like legitimately had a blood coming out of his from under his eye. And when he came out for his next match, he had a puffy eye. So you got to be careful. But like, yeah, it can look really, really, you know, there's like the cross arm breaker. Like, there are ways to make it look really nasty and impressive without having to like jump off the top rope to finish a guy.
Yeah. So if you are planning on getting into wrestling anytime soon.
Yes. For all the aspiring wrestlers who no doubt listen to this.
Don't take a submission. Don't pick a move where you have to take a bump to do your finisher. Pick a submission.
So I think that the takeaway in addition to that is that you should go see live wrestling if you have the option, because it's a lot of fun.
Yeah. The one thing I wanted to mention that I mentioned to you before the show was that the demographic for the show was not what I was used to for independent wrestling shows. You know, when I used to go to independent shows with you in the US, and even when I was there last month, like the crowd is usually this kind of 90% male, kind of 90% male, 50% douchebag, scumbag, dirtbag kind of ratio going on. And it was really not like that at this show. There was a jarring number of women there.
This is really interesting to me.
I want to say genuinely half the crowd was probably women. And not women who were there with, like, their boyfriend, but women who had come because they're fans of wrestling and they wanted to see the show. So, like, you know, women there with just their other friend who is a woman, and they're just there to see wrestling. And, you know, I talked to one of the woman who was sitting next to me, and, you know, she was asking about, you know, Joey Ryan, like, is he popular in the U.S. and, like, is he a good wrestler? Do people, you know, do people know him and stuff like that? And, like, I was, you know, explaining about Joey Ryan to her, and she was legitimately interested in this kind of thing. Like, she really liked the wrestling, and, like, you know, she had a picture of a wrestler as the wallpaper on her phone, that kind of thing. Like, it wasn't she wasn't, like, there with, I mean, she was there with her friend who had two kids with her, but, like, the kids were not interested in the wrestling at all. So it was just like those two girls were really into the wrestling and just happened to have kids with them.
Yeah, it is a different, much different vibe at U.S. shows, as you know. Although Mark and I are going to see a WWE house show on Sunday, and that will be probably the most, like, racially diverse crowd I'll belong to at an event this year. Like, that's the thing that always impresses me at WWE shows. It's usually, like, half non-white people, at least in the Northeast. And I like that. Although it's still pretty heavily, like, male or families. It's a much different vibe than indie wrestling shows, which tend to be a lot of white dudes. Well, which, you know, fine, whatever.
But I can, like, tell you that the DDTPro show was not racially diverse. Unless unless you consider diversity being me and the guy I went with as the only white people there. Actually, not even the only white people, the only non-Japanese people there.
Because, yeah, you and the guy you went with and Joey Ryan.
And Joey Ryan, yeah.
Well, so yeah, so a lot of good indie stuff out there, a lot of good live wrestling stuff out there.
So yeah, if you happen to be in Tokyo and you want to see wrestling, there's wrestling every day, like virtually every day, at various places, various buildings, and various promotions. Like, seriously, it would be hard to find it's harder to find a day with no wrestling than it is to find a day with wrestling.
So here it's not quite as intense, but it's more like every weekend day. I have to actually sort of, like, sort of pick and choose my spots, because I could just go to see wrestling Friday, Saturday, Sunday night every weekend.
I don't know why you're not doing that.
It's financially ruinous. speaking of financially ruinous, I want to talk about Bernie Sanders. No, I do want to talk about Bernie Sanders, actually, because our next topic is wrestling and politics.
Well, I mean, if we're going to talk about financially ruinous, we should start with Linda McMahon's various campaigns in our home state.
Joe and I were not the only ones attending indie wrestling shows over the weekend. Vermont Senator, Socialist Senator Bernie Sanders was campaigning in Des Moines, Iowa, and there was an event called Latino Fest. So he went, and because at least somebody who's not Vince McMahon understands that people from Mexico like wrestling, there was a wrestling event at Latino Fest as a local promotion, 3X Wrestling. And so Bernie Sanders stayed and watched the wrestling and gamely posed, giving a wrestler a headlock, echoing a famous, well, maybe famous to me, photo of Jimmy Carter, then Governor Jimmy Carter, giving Mr. Wrestling 2 a headlock. And so then, like, a lot of, you know, people were tweeting, like, a lot of wrestling fans who like Bernie Sanders were like, this clinches it, Bernie, you know, whatever.
Feeling the burn. Feeling
the burn. Hashtag Bernie Sanders wrestling champ. So, but this got me thinking, it was funny too, because Jim Cornette is a big Bernie Sanders supporter, and he was tweeting all the stuff about it, and he was retweeting all these Bernie Sanders campaign things. And, like, I love when he does that, because a lot of his fans are very, like, old school Southern people. And just the responses to his, like, he's, like, tweeting things in support of Planned Parenthood or whatever, and then there's, like, all these people who are in it, like, Obama's doing a great job, and then, like, he'll get all these responses from his followers, like, sir, I did not realize you were a socialist Benghazi, you know, like, it's just crazy. I love it.
I have followed Jim Cornette on Twitter also, and I think watching the responses he gets, that when, because, like, you know, Jim Cornette is like a hilarious guy in the sense that like he is constantly breaking the stereotype you would have of him. Like
Yes, absolutely.
if I had said like, Jim Cornette, he's like this old school Southern wrestling guy, you would get, oh, he's probably like a crazed conservative and a racist.
Right.
Like it's just the stereotype you might have because like a lot of people actually fall into it. But
No, that's right, yeah.
like he's like this rabid liberal, and he like he's an atheist, and he's like constantly like on about how much he hates religion and stuff, and then he's like constantly, like he's re been recently retweeting all those things about Planned Parenthood and his support for Planned Parenthood and about Bernie Sanders and like all of this stuff like that. And it's hilarious because like I think a lot of people who are fans of his don't realize that he's like that, but when they see his Twitter feed, they do have that kind of reaction because like, if you just find one of those posts by Jim Cornette and you just like click on it and see like the responses, it's always hilarious because there's always people who are just like, I didn't realize this is like what you were like, and I can't support it.
Yeah, it's magnificent. Yeah, I'm not like I like Jim Cornette for what he's done in the past. I think a lot of his opinions now are kind of kooky and goofy on wrestling and things, but I love that he's still like getting a reaction out of people, which is why they liked him in the first place, right? Because he was the heel. I mean, he was the guy who like made crowds want to kill him, and he's still sort of doing that on Twitter. It's neat. But this got us thinking about wrestling and politics, and it's sort of interesting when you think about it to look over the weird intersections of wrestling and politics in the United States and in Japan.
Yes, in Japan.
So like the obvious highlight, I think, in terms of wrestling and politics, Jesse the Body Ventura.
Yeah, that one, I remember when he was elected and we were thinking like this is amazing and awesome. And it turned out that like he wasn't like a terrible governor or anything either, which is, says a bit for Jesse Ventura.
Right. And he was he was interesting because he was a what, Reform Party or whatever. He was
Yeah, he
not
was a third party candidate. He wasn't even like a Democrat or a Republican. Like he was a just like a th third party guy who came in and won the vote.
And I remember too, like towards the end, I think the end of his time in the state house there, he was like kind of bored with being governor. And so he started doing like color commentary for the XFL. It was like with the governor of the state, and then they would like, because it was the XFL, so I remember they the like ratings started to tank, and so they started to do like wrestling things, like they started to do angles, but like the actual football people like had no clue what was going on, but the wrestling people did. So like Jesse Ventura like confronted the coach of one team who like chose to kick a field goal instead of going for it on fourth down. Gutless Rusty. And I loved that. He was governor of a state and he was like playing this character on TV. Fantastic. Yeah, he's the most successful, but he's not the only one. One that springs to mind that is not as well known to me would be, although he's one of my favorites, is Tom Drake. Tom Drake was a lawmaker in Alabama. And he eventually became, I believe, Speaker of the House in the Alabama State Legislature. He was like a reformist. He was like not a racist. He was actually did a lot of good things in government. But he got his start after his initial foray into politics. He got his start as a famous person wrestling, and he was also like into politics, and so his gimmick, I love this, his gimmick was that he was Tom Drake, the wrestling lawmaker, which was also his real life.
It's so good. The
And he, I mean,
idea that he could be doing both of those things at the same time and like not having anybody care is amazing.
he started out like in the late 40s and wrestled, I mean, some of the greats. He wrestled Lou Thesz, he wrestled Gorgeous George, he wrestled Tojo Yamamoto. He wrestled up into the 70s, like long after he'd been elected. he was first elected in the 60s, and he wrestled until 1978. He was very old school. His finisher was the dropkick, which actually will take a lot out of you. But yeah, so at the time that he was like an important Alabama lawmaker, he was Tom Drake, the wrestling lawmaker. Not everyone is quite as successful as Jesse Ventura at Tom Drake. You alluded to Linda McMahon from our home state of Connecticut.
Yes. Oh man, Linda McMahon had how many failed campaigns? Two, three?
Two that together cost about $100 million of her own money.
Yeah. See, the problem with Linda McMahon's campaign is that she's running as a Republican in Connecticut.
Right.
You've got no chance.
No.
And if you're also saddled with being connected to the World Wrestling Entertainment, you are definitely not going to win, because you know the people who are going to vote for you are already think of you as a dirtbag.
Yeah, she ran against who is now U.S. Senator Richard Blumenthal at the time. He's Attorney General, and then in 2000, that was in 2010, she lost. And then in 2012, it was an open Senate seat. Joe Lieberman was not running again. No, it was Chris Dodd who wasn't running again. And so she was running against this congressman, Chris Murphy, who was like a terrible, terrible candidate. And maybe I shouldn't say that because I work for the state. But anyway, he was. And I remember they were having a debate where I work. And there are all these like high school kids that were like had all these Linda McMahon signs, like lots of high school kids. And I was working the debate. And so I went up to one of the kids and I'm like, what do you like about Linda McMahon? And the kid's like, oh, no, their campaign paid us all $50 and gave us free pizza if we'd come out here and wave signs. Like, that's so wrestling.
that's very wrestling. That's
such a carny move. Go to the local high school, get those kids some pizza.
That's great though. I would have done that for $50 in pizza.
I would have done $50 in pizza. Yeah, I don't gotta go and wave signs for Linda. She lost by double digits. But there's rumors that she might get back into it. But you're right. She's run as a Republican in Connecticut, and Connecticut is one of the least Republican states in the United States. And you know, and people don't like her. Like she's got this kind of, you know, people in Connecticut, so they like a certain temperament, and she doesn't have it. Also, in our home congressional district, Bob Backlund once ran for Congress as a Republican.
That's true. He did. Remind us, Tom, of his campaign motto.
His legitimate campaign motto was, "I will improve my ability to read." Not I, the voter. I, Bob Backlund. I guess he had been like dyslexic or something, and sort of late in life kind of came back to like becoming like fully like learn how to read and everything, which is inspiring and great, but it's a weird thing to base your congressional campaign on.
Really strange.
I voted for him though. He got killed. I mean, he absolutely didn't, you know, nobody, the first district congressman is this Democrat. Nobody ever beats him, but, I vote. Cause I mean, like how many times in your life do you get to vote for a professional wrestler?
It's true. The thing with the Bob Backlund thing, I really like that you voted for him because a friend of ours was working for the opposing campaign.
That's right.
and like not just like someone we know, like someone we're like good friends with that we hang out with all the time. And you're like, yeah, voting against your job, dude.
It's true. Yeah, he's still mad at me all these years later. But like I knew Bob Backlund was going to lose. It was a close, like Bob, you know, Bob Backlund, although I will say he lost. He did better than any other Republican opponent the incumbent has ever had. The incumbent usually wins with like 70% of the vote, and I think Backlund got like 36%. So it was like it was closer than it has been because you know Bob Backlund lives in the area. Everyone knows him. He's a well-liked guy. He had like hilarious lawn signs. I still have one of them. Remember his when he came back in WWE, he was wearing the red suspenders and the bow tie.
Yes,
like that's what his lawn signs looked like. They were like, you know, they had red suspenders and a bow tie. I still have one.
That's great. I remember those too. That was a really good a good sign. All of that was really good. Bob Backlund was a great guy to be running, even though like he had no chance.
No, but in fairness, like no Republican in the first district has a chance.
Yeah, I mean, it's not because it was Bob Backlund. It was because nobody has a chance if you're Republican in the first district. That's it.
Of course, we'd be remiss if we were talking about wrestling and politics and we didn't mention WWE Hall of Famer and current frontrunner in the GOP presidential race, Donald Trump.
This is hilarious to me. Like, the Donald Trump thing is like, it's really funny because, like, you know, he was in a hair versus hair match or whatever in WWE, like, not too long ago.
No.
Now he is running for president. Like, it's really strange to think of Donald Trump running, and not just because, like, I think he's ridiculous, but because of, like, he's got so many years of being, you know, loudmouth Donald Trump and doing various goofy things. Like, the guy has a board game and a TV show and, like, a game show and all these other weird things, like a casino. Like, it's too weird to, like, imagine that guy being the president, only because, like, you could be like, well, you know, he's our president and all, but, you know, he had this board game in the 80s that we can play too. It's so weird to me. It's like, it's just like a strange mixing of things that you wouldn't expect. It's like not what I think a normal person would consider presidential.
But you know what? I honestly think that's part of his appeal. Like, I think one of the reasons people are responding to him is that he's not a typical politician. Because politicians suck; they're the worst. And I think the fact that, like, and I want to say, you know, for the record, Donald Trump is a crazy idiot. I disagree with everything he thinks for the most part. There are actually some things he said that are sort of smart when he says that the whole system is controlled by private money and shouldn't be. That's accurate. But I mean, he's just appealing to the worst instincts about people. However, I think the reason people like him is because they hate politicians. They legitimately hate politicians. And I totally understand that. And he's not. He's just this guy who gets up and just says whatever comes into his mind. Being his press secretary must be the most fun thing in the world because you never apologize. You never walk anything back. Like, he just comes out and he says this stupid, crazy garbage. And you're just like, yep, Donald said it.
I kind of want that job. Because, like, all you have to do be is like an unrepentant douchebag. It's great. And I think I agree. I think that is actually a lot of his appeal. That, and, like, it seems, you know, because I'm friends with a lot of people on Facebook, from, you know, various points in my life, like just like people we went to high school with that I don't haven't talked to in a long time or whatever. And, like, sometimes you'll get people who are like Trump supporters in my feed, and I feel like, what it's like fascinating to me as to, like, their reasons for being Trump supporters. And a lot of them have to do with things like that, where it's just like, you know, Donald Trump doesn't have to lie like a politician or whatever. He just says
Right.
what he really believes and what people really think or whatever. And that's, like, kind of the reason people like him. And I kind of understand that because, like, you know, if he were like somebody on the opposite end, like saying things that I liked in the same kind of way, I would feel like, oh, I probably would vote for that guy, even if it
Right.
was someone, you know, like Donald Trump, who, you know, has a board game and a TV show and stuff like that. You know what I
Yeah.
mean? Like, if it was someone equally as ridiculous on the opposite end.
Yeah, there's actually sort of a more direct connection between Donald Trump and wrestling, more explicit rather, made by Judd, I'm going to say this wrong, Ligum. He's the editor-in-chief of Think Progress, which is a left-leaning website. He wrote this really interesting article I'll post on the blog about Roland Barthes, who any brainy wrestling fan knows wrote a famous essay in 1957 about professional wrestling that really gets the sport or the spectacle done well. And Judd Ligum argues that, like, you have to read Roland Barthes on wrestling to understand the appeal of Trump's campaign. It's a really interesting piece. He basically says that for the same reason wrestling is successful, Trump is being successful right now. And he quotes a section from the Barthes essay on wrestling. It says, "It is obvious that at such a point, it no longer matters whether the passion is genuine or not. What the public wants is the image of passion, not passion itself. There is no more problem of truth in wrestling than in the theater." And so he's arguing that this is the reason that Trump is able to, like, outfox all his opponents, because they're like, you know, like picking apart his tax plan. Like, that is not why people are interested in Donald Trump. Like, they're interested in this image he projects as a guy who doesn't care and will get things done, because that's what people want, or at least that's what 25% of the Republican primary voters want. And the fact that nobody can sort of figure this out, it's really interesting that so Donald Trump, who does have this wrestling connection, like, as you said, he was in a hair versus hair match against, well, it's sort of a match by proxy against Vince McMahon. at the same time has like really picked up the showmanship aspect of wrestling. And it's like, you're doing something that everyone knows is fake, but it doesn't matter because that's not the point. And the fact that his opponents don't get that is why they're doing so badly against him.
Yeah. I mean, that's a really, smart analysis, I think. And it rings true to me. I think like that kind of thing makes sense because, you know, like you said, attacking something like his tax plan is not a smart idea because nobody cares. Nobody cares about anybody's tax plan because, you know, the thing with it is that the president isn't the person who decides the tax plans.
That's no, right.
The stuff has to go through a Congress and the House of Representatives too. There's nothing that the president can't even like make that stuff. It's not even like his call.
No, yeah, like I have a lot of friends who are Bernie Sanders supporters, and they always say things like, well, he's going to get rid of student loan debt. I'm like, well, how though? Like, the president's not in charge of student loan debt. Like, he can't just go into office and like write it off. Like, there are two other branches of government to think about, my friend. You're absolutely right. Like, Trump is just a guy, they want someone who doesn't play the game. And Trump is a guy who doesn't play the game. And I think even a lot of his supporters know, like, he's not going to be president. But they like the fact that he's just like sticking it to people right now who they don't like.
That's absolutely true. And I think that's the appeal of those kinds of people. I think in a lot of ways, that was the appeal in like 96 and 2000 for Ralph Nader.
Yeah.
When, you know, people complained about Ralph Nader, like in 96, I voted for Ralph Nader. And I thought, like, you know, he has no chance of winning. He didn't get even 1% of the vote. But, like, I thought, I just like what he says. And I think, like, if you're paying attention and you like what the person says, that's who you should vote for. And yep. I think, like, that's kind of the mindset for a lot of people who are thinking of supporting Trump, in that, like, he plays into that kind of thing. Like, he is saying what they want to hear. And I think a lot of the idea of it is that he can't actually do a lot of this stuff. The president has a lot less power than people seem to imagine the president has. The president can't enact laws. The president can't do these things that are on his platform by himself. It's not how the presidency works.
Right.
So like these kinds of platforms that people bring out are like things they have to work with people on and get, you know, people in the House and the Senate behind them to actually, you know, pass these things. So, but people don't think of it that way. They think, like, they say, you know, Bernie Sanders wants to give free college to everybody. Okay, like, that's a lofty goal. Like, I think it's a good thing, but good luck with that. How are you going to get that passed anywhere?
Right, exactly. Yeah, you're going to have to deal with Congress, and like Congress is not going to be socialist from Vermont.
Yeah, that's the thing. Like, this is why, like, someone like Bernie Sanders, like, even if he won, would be a horrible disappointment to all those people who supported him. And also on top of that, Trump has the same problem. I mean, he'll be a horrible disappointment if he were to win. He would be a horrible disappointment to those people because he has no power to do any of the things that he says he wants to do.
It's true. He's fascinating for that reason, I think, as a phenomenon in American politics. And I think understanding wrestling actually helps you understand Trump better.
Yeah, I like that. I like that he is very much the WWE of candidates. Like
he really is.
He is very showy and very much like larger than life.
Yep.
I mean, in a Trump way. I mean, it's not like he's slamming people, though he should.
Yeah, he should. But he's like a cartoony, he's like, you know, like a Hollywood version of a business tycoon. Like, actual business tycoons are not like Donald Trump, right? But he's this guy who, like, that's exactly, if you ask, like, the average person, like, what do you think, like, super rich people are like? Donald Trump is what they think of. You know, just the way that in WWE, it's like, well, what is, like, a kind of an angry redneck like? Steve Austin is what angry rednecks are like. It's really interesting as a phenomenon in politics. But the United States is not the only country that has had wrestlers involved in politics. Antonio Inoki Is that right?
Yes. Japan has had like this weird kind of thing where, okay, Japan has elections all the time. Like, I don't know that there's a set schedule. I have no idea, but it seems like there's elections going on all the time. And they have like the diet system where there's like an upper house and a lower house, and there's like hundreds and hundreds of lawmakers in the diet. So like you have really local people that have these like kind of local elections, and you have like your kind of party elections, and then you have like these elections within the parties, and it's like a really complicated system. And it's not like the US system. I think it's more like a British system, where there's like the kind of upper house and lower house, and you have, you know, like I think the diet has like 500 something people in it in the lower house, maybe the lower house only, and then like 200 in the upper house. It's like so many people. And I'm probably really wrong on that actually, but I know there's like hundreds and hundreds of people in the diet. It's just imagine that. The numbers I said might be wrong, but you know, because there's a ton of these like smaller local elections, like getting elected to the diet is like something that can happen for a lot of people. And Antonio Inoki is one of those people, but there's been others like Antonio Inoki is like essentially the Hulk Hogan of Japan. Like he is someone everybody knows. He's got like his own like chain of restaurants, and he's got like his TV specials every year. And he's like a face and a character that virtually everybody recognizes. So like having him win something for like a governmental election is not like off the charts weird, because he's so famous that it just makes sense that he could win one of these things. But there's other people who have won, other people in wrestling who have won diet seats that are way off the charts for like people you would expect to be in government. And one of them is the great Sasuke, who is a master wrestler, and he participated in government wearing the mask. He never took the mask off.
This is awesome. There are pictures. I guess he was in something called a prefectural assembly, which is that more like a state government?
Yes, yes.
There's pictures of him like voting and like debating and participating in government in this assembly, like with his mask on.
Yes, he has the mask on, which is ridiculous. But imagine like if you're just like you go to like a state assembly or something in the U.S. and like one of the elected officials is wearing a wrestling mask.
Wearing a wrestling mask, yeah. That is amazing. Like, I can't stress enough how much I love that and how much I wish we could have something like that.
Okay, but there's an even weirder one than that.
Oh my
God. Is someone you would never imagine being part of a government just for the the obviously poor decisions he makes in his life. this is Atsushi Onita, who is like the king of the deathmatch. Like, Onita is famous for like barbed wire exploding ring matches. Like, he's like the innovator. The
founder of garbage wrestling.
Yeah,
really.
Pretty much. Like, you know, if you want to see someone get like, you want to see like probably the first matches where people get smashed into light bulbs and then slammed on tacks and then exploded while wrapped in barbed wire, it's probably something Atsushi Onita did first. And like, he was elected to the diet in Japan. Like, he was a legit, like, countrywide politician. Atsushi Onita.
That is crazy.
It would be like, it would be like electing Sabu to something.
Oh man, Sabu for president.
I mean, I would vote for Sabu for president, but I think a normal person would not.
Oh, right.
And
yeah, no, that's true.
Any, like, if Sabu ran for anything anywhere, he'd have no chance of winning. Let's be honest here.
No, yeah. No.
You know, like, a group of Boy Scouts wouldn't vote for him for troop leader. Like,
yeah, it would just be a terrible idea to have Sabu in charge of anything. Think about it.
Yeah, just like think of the life decisions he's made. Atsushi Onita is like that. Like,
I mean, I love Sabu, but let's be honest here, folks.
So Onita is not, I don't think he's in, I'm pretty sure he's not in the government anymore because he's back to doing death matches and things again. But,
right.
Yeah, it's really weird. Imagine, like, Nick Gage gets somehow his, like, state rep now.
Oh my God, that would be amazing.
That's the kind of thing. It's like, you know, the innovator of death matches. The guy who essentially inspired all of that crazy ECW barbed wire bloodfest from the 90s. Like, he was in the government in Japan. Like, you can't really top that. There's not, you know, there's people in the US, like other wrestlers who got elected to the thing, like Rick Steiner.
Right.
But
yeah, like in local government.
But man, Atsushi Onita was in like the federal government of Japan. That's insane to me.
Yeah, I agree. And I mean, I love that. I think there's a lot there. Maybe the most like profound insights about wrestling and politics can be found by contemplating Donald Trump, but the most fun ones definitely involve the phenomenon in which Atsushi Onita is elected in charge of an important, or elected in a national government. I mean, think about it.
Yeah, I mean, there's other wrestlers that have been in Japan's government also. Hiroshi Hase is another one, but like, I mean, he's really tame compared to like Atsushi Onita, and like even Antonio Inoki is like incredibly tame compared to Atsushi Onita. Like, you would think, right, like, oh well, okay, you know, because he's like essentially Hulk Hogan, minus the, I mean, racist sex tape or whatever,
right. Although Hulk Hogan has never run for office, although he has, like, jokingly kind of talked about running for president, but he's never, to my knowledge, Hulk Hogan has never run for office. Probably can't now.
Yeah, probably not now, but you never know. I mean, it's Florida, after all, he lives in.
No, that's true. Yeah, yeah, exactly. That's a good point. Well, let's see. Before we go, I wanted to talk about the promoter of the year, because I got into this little thing online with Voices of Wrestling, which is a blog, it's another podcast and a website and everything, and they're quickly becoming the home of the sizzling hot take. And so,
well, wait a second, Tom. You should explain sizzling hot take to the listeners, because
right. Yeah, so if you don't know, like, hot take is sort of a mocking term for, like, people who look at something in the news and just try to say something deliberately provocative about it, without really having sort of much substance or thought behind what they're saying. So, like, you know, it's calling something a hot take is a way of kind of mocking somebody who's, like, actually thinking they're putting across, like, a provocative opinion when, in fact, it's just full of hot air. And Voices of Wrestling does this a lot. There's a lot of, you know, like, they'll talk about how, like, oh, Sasha Banks is the most overrated wrestler in the world, and NXT is like a vanity promotion, and, you know, it's like they just run down everything because they want to be people who are seen as having, like, controversial things to say. And this is a big thing in like professional sports. If you watch ESPN, as I do occasionally, like, it's full of molten hot takes. Like, you need your oven mitts before handling those hot takes on, like, whatever it happens to be. You know, because, like, sports stuff doesn't matter, right? So you don't have to worry about, you know, having any kind of responsible decision making in what you're saying. Like, you can just look at something in sports, like, you know, and say, like, you know what, the Patriots should be set on fire, whatever. Like, you can just say stupid stuff because it's sports; it doesn't matter. But that's kind of how you get ahead of the crowd by saying stupidly provocative stuff. So today, for whatever reason, they were talking about the promoter of the year, which I guess is, maybe it's a Wrestling Observer Newsletter category. So they were like, who's the promoter of the year right now? Can't be VKM. For insiders, that's Vincent Kennedy McMahon. Can't be VKM with ratings and attendance in the shitter. And then someone tweeted them and was like, well, what about Triple H? Because he's basically the promoter of NXT. And the Voice of Wrestling was like, NXT loses boatloads of money, right? Okay, so this is my thing. Like, if we're going to talk about whoever the promoter of the year is, which, by the way, is kind of like a stupid discussion, and money is your category, it's always Vince McMahon. It's always Vince McMahon. WWE is in a business category unto itself. Like, their ratings are down, yes. Their attendance was down in the second quarter, but not in the first quarter or the current third quarter. But they're still making lots of money. They're making more money this year than they made last year. They actually lost money last year because of the network. They're making a lot of money this year compared to last year and the year before. The network, with more than a million subscribers stabilized, is actually bringing them more revenue than pay-per-view did. So, like, if money is your measurement of quality in wrestling, which it probably should not be, but often is, then the answer is always Vince McMahon. Vince is always the promoter of the year, right? But then if you're like, if you're looking for art or something, then Triple H is a good candidate because NXT has actually been a really good product.
But I think it's obvious that Lucha Underground wins.
Yeah, I mean, I don't even know the promoter. That, like, how is that even? Because, like, it's a weird. I would say wrestling show of the year, definitely. Mm-hmm. But is it like? Is it actually like a? I mean, is it, it's more of a show about a wrestling show, right?
I have no idea. It's great though.
It is great.
It seems like a show about a wrestling show, actually. But. It's not, but there's actually wrestling on it. So, I mean, and the crowd is real in the
right.
sense that they're not, the entire crowd isn't paid to be there.
Right.
So
that has been my favorite wrestling show of the year, whoever the promoter is.
Yeah. Whoever, is the, promoter, writer, whatever, of Lucha Underground, it's a bang up job. Can't wait for season two.
If you're gonna like exclude McMahon, I don't even know what answer you're looking for, like, because if you're talking about like indie promotions, I mean, I don't know, it's a weird category to even have, like, I sent them, I emailed them, or I tweeted at them, because as luck would have it, WWE released its updated key performance indicators financial report today, and so it had a lot of interesting business stuff in it, and I tweeted at them and said, you know, so if money is your standard, Vince McMahon is the promoter of the year. And they responded, counter argument, WrestleMania lost money, ratings in the shitter, they love that phrase, in the shitter, attendance in the shitter, gross money versus context applies here. I don't know what gross money versus context is. Like, gross doesn't matter, we're talking about net, and net, they're ahead of where they were 2 years ago, and I don't know what the context is. If you're just talking about producing like a fun, entertaining wrestling program, then whoever the quote unquote promoter of Lucha Underground is the head and shoulders winner.
Yeah, but even if you don't consider Lucha Underground in the running because you think it's a TV show over like a wrestling show, okay, well, I mean, even then, like, WWE isn't in the lead there. I mean, almost everything is better in terms of entertainment because it's usually shorter. And I mean, Ring of Honor would win.
And like, Ring of Honor is good, but I haven't, to me, they're in sort of like a down period right now. They have a lot of good stuff, but that just seems kind of directionless.
But even then, like, it's still like their hour long show is entertaining to watch for the wrestling.
Yep. Definitely.
I mean, there's not like a lot of stuff going on. Like, I couldn't tell you any of the main angles that are going on right now, but, you know, I still watch it because the wrestling matches are good. Whereas, like, you know, NXT is actually pretty good. I mean, I sort of good right now. Since, like, you know, they pulled away all the people that were the biggest people, or they're injured or whatever, you know, it's that kind of thing. But, you know, now NXT is in kind of a low point, but I think it'll pick back up once they get more people into the flow of things, I guess.
Yeah, and by bringing in Kana from Japan and Athena from the Indies, like, they are definitely making a commitment to having a fantastic women's division in NXT. That's exciting to see, because for a minute there, it looked like they were like drifting over into the like Dana Brooke, Eva Marie lane, and that would not have been as exciting.
Yeah, and I think like on the opposite end, the male side of NXT is actually pretty weak right now. Like, the female side is still okay, but man, like, what are the you've got Finn Balor and
Samoa Joe,
like, what else? Who else does anybody care about?
it's not real star-studded right now.
Yeah. So it's the kind of thing where, you know, having the women there is like actually like a pretty good thing for NXT at the moment, because like it's the thing that people care about the most, I think, for what's going on in NXT at the moment. And like having Sasha Banks show up there still, and having like people who are, you know, going to have good matches show up is, you know, a good idea, because there's not a lot of star power, and like the star power they had is either injured or not on the roster anymore.
Right. Yeah. It's sort of this is kind of a down period for them, it seems like. And it'll be interesting to see kind of how they, because they were on a real hot streak from like, I'd say end of last summer until right around this summer, when, you know, Sami Zayn got hurt and Kevin Owens went up to the main roster and Hideo Itami got hurt. So I'll be curious to see how they kind of pull out of this. I don't know that they figured out how to use Terry Crews yet. He's sort of kind of lost in the mix, and they've got to do a little something to differentiate some of the younger guys coming in. But they've put on like really interesting, better than WWE stuff. So they're definitely worth watching.
Yeah, I mean, I like NXT, but, you know, currently I'm just like waiting for them to hook me back with something to make it more exciting. As far as like promoter of the year, it feels like something that would be part of like PWI ratings, because it seems like something that would be outdated in 1985.
Yeah, it really does.
Like in the 70s, it seems like you would have like a ton of choices. Even in the early 80s, but like past like, you know, like the late 80s, you've got nothing. Like there are no more promoters. You know,
it's Vince McMahon and a bunch of small fry, like, well, and Paul Heyman in the 90s.
Yeah. Well, I mean, you had like Vince McMahon, Paul Heyman, and whoever was running WCW. No one seemed to know.
Right, that's the thing. Like, was there a promoter? Like, Time Warner wasn't a promoter.
Yeah.
That's the same. Like, Ring of Honor. Like, who's the promoter? They're owned by Sinclair Broadcasting. It's not like they have a booker, but they don't have. It's, you know.
Yeah, that's the thing. Like, a lot of the wrestling that isn't something minor is not really run by a person. There's not a promoter. I mean,
no.
Who is your promoter for New Japan? It's like whatever corporation is running New Japan.
Right.
And, you know, there's bookers. Yeah, you're right. There are bookers. I mean, everybody knows who the bookers are for New Japan and WWE and stuff like that. But those aren't the promoters. So, you know, it is kind of like it's not like Jim Crockett Promotions or whatever. You know, can be like, oh, yeah, Jim Crockett really killed it this year. Or like, you know, Cowboy Bill Watts totally killed it this year in UPW or whatever. Or
right, because like, you know, the territories were sort of in the territory days. I mean, you had guys who they all, at least in the NWA, all worked as part of like a national network. And then you could talk about who was the best promoter. But if you're talking about all these like really tiny indies, the discussion doesn't seem to have much point to me, because it's like nobody's really making a huge noise outside their local area, with like, the exception of like PWG. And even PWG has like six owners.
Yeah. You know? I mean, like for your like big indies, like you have PWG and you have Evolve and stuff like that, but like nobody's keeping track enough of those to say like this guy was, you know, Evolve's promoter was totally better than PWG's this year,
right?
Like nobody even knows who those guys are for the most part. I mean, Gabe Sapolsky, people know him, but
yeah, but like who's keeping track of, like, you know, you're like, oh, what about, you know, I mean, even sort of like the bigger type indies, like who's watching all of them? Like there's just too much stuff to keep track of, whereas in the old days in the NWA there were some like major territories, and like you always sort of knew what they were doing because they would get coverage in magazines and like their guys would be wrestling for the top belts. But like now, who the hell knows?
Yeah, that's why I think the idea of it seems like an really old PWI kind of listing, like something that they probably would have gotten rid of or should have gotten rid of if it's still there. Otherwise, like it's kind of like a silly topic overall, only because like nobody knows who that is, and like the landscape is so entirely different that, like, you know, even if like PWG was killing it for the entire year, who has seen it enough to say like it was better than NXT or WWE. Like, frankly, like, if you're a wrestling fan these days, like, you know, you probably watch WWE and maybe go to indie shows every once in a while, or maybe watch TNA or something, or right. Ring of Honor if you get Destination America. It's that kind of thing where, like, you know, there's not a lot of choices for your promotions, and comparing them is really difficult because there's a ridiculous size difference.
Yeah, and I think even if you're like, so you're a fan of some indies in the area, like I am. I go to indie shows a lot in the area, so I know a lot about Beyond Wrestling, for example, in Northeast Wrestling, but I've never seen an absolute intense wrestling show, even though you can stream it. And like, I don't follow Chikara that much. I'm sort of vaguely aware of what PWG does on their big shows, but I don't like watch every show. Like, it's the thing, like, even if you sort of keep up with it, there's so much to keep up with that unless you're spending all your money on streaming services and DVDs and stuff, like, there's no way to like say, oh yeah, Beyond Wrestling is much better than, you know, Chaotic Pro Wrestling, which is not quite as good as Absolute Intense. Like, I mean, there's so many wrestling promotions out there.
Yeah. I mean, if you're just like generic promoter of the year, you've got way too many people to consider and no real metric of deciding how, whereas like in the past you might have, like, you know, if you're like, you know, Mid-South versus Memphis, who had a better year, like, you could probably have done that.
Right.
But
they had a similar scale and it was easier to compare.
Yeah. Whereas now, if you're just like even comparing WWE and NXT is difficult because there's like a huge scale difference there.
Yep.
I mean, comparing WWE and TNA is like, you can't even do.
No.
And like, if you want to insert Ring of Honor in there, like you've like, it's like comparing like an indie film to a Hollywood blockbuster.
Yeah. It just doesn't make sense.
The content could be good, but like how are you just judging on the content? Apparently not. If you're judging by how much money you made or lost. If that's a criteria, if that's one of the criterion, you have to go with the biggest one every time.
I think it's just there's a species of wrestling fan that just loves to argue about shit.
Yeah. I think that is, those kinds of people are the people that, make people think we're dirtbags.
Yeah, I mean, among others, there was I posted this on the blog, but there was a guy from the Baltimore City Paper, which is a really good alt weekly, as alt weeklies go, and like he was trying to understand wrestling. I guess he has friends who are wrestling fans, so like it's an alt weekly, so it's like hipster, like, you know, kind of a yuppie thing. And he goes with his friends to an indie show in Baltimore, and it's just this nightmare. Here's a quote from it. Unfortunately, the night also encapsulated many people's worst preconceived notions about wrestling and its fans in that it was weirdly racist and sexist. Namely, two announcers trying to humor the crowd made a bunch of references to lesbian sex during a women's match because it would be impossible to simply consider them as athletes. One of the wrestlers was part of a faction of African-American business executives, cum wrestlers, called Black Wall Street, which prompted an announcer to quip, "Black Wall Street, the only place where you can put transactions on layaway." And like, it's 2015. I mean, like, and I mean, I should say that the wrestling stuff I go to in the Northeast, like, that would never play. Right? Like, I'm not saying it's all a bunch of like sophisticates at wrestling shows up here, but it's a different climate. Like, you can't get away with that shit up here, which is good, because 15 years ago you definitely could.
Oh yeah.
So I think it's a sign of progress that people would never put up with that now, but it's still out there in wrestling shows, a lot of wrestling fans are dirtbags, let's be honest.
Yeah. Again, it has a lot. I mean, we talked about the kind of class descriptors of wrestling fans. Like, there are like kind of stereotypes for what kinds of people like wrestling, and yep. You know, there are stereotypes. But, you know, they're stereotypes for a reason. And, you know, I think like that's not to say like all wrestling fans are kind of like inbred hillbillies or like, subnormal IQ troglodytes. It's just a, you know, more than half. But the thing with it is that, like, there is a wrestling does appeal to a wide variety of people, as you know, as we mentioned, you know, the wrestlers have been elected to government positions. For someone who was a president was a fan of wrestling enough to pose in a picture with Mr. Wrestling too. This kind of thing is like, you know, there is a wide variety of people who like wrestling, despite the image of it being like for poor, dumb people. And I think like it hasn't really escaped that kind of image. Like, because, I mean, in spite of like trying, a lot of the things like this article you mentioned kind of reinforced the idea of like, you know, I wasn't sure about wrestling. And then I went to this wrestling show and it was just like totally racist and sexist.
Right.
Like, oh, well, you know, you guys aren't helping by doing that. You're not helping wrestling.
And no, no, that's the thing. Like that those, whoever the announced team was at that thing, like, lost a chance to win new converts over, because like, instead of being able to go back and write as, you know, a story for City Paper saying like, I thought wrestling was one thing, but it's actually this other thing and it's pretty great. Like, now a guy goes in and is like, oh, you know, I enjoyed some of what I saw, but too bad everyone was like, you know, the announcers were racist, you know, creeps. It's just, you're absolutely right. It's just a self-inflicted wound.
Yeah, and I feel like that's a bad thing. I mean, it's bad that, you know, you can't tell people you like wrestling without people scoffing in a general conversation. You know what I mean? Like, without having to be on the defensive immediately.
Oh yeah.
I think that is, you know, the kind of thing where it's kind of a shame, because there is like and we've talked about this extensively, about the kind of wrestling isn't like two meatheads beating each other up. That's not the point of it.
No, it's not.
There is like a kind of story and kind of play style entertainment to it that is, you know, on the level of something that people consider more, you know, more acceptable. But because it's wrestling, it has like a bad kind of stigma attached to it, because of, you know, not only because of some of the stuff that is attached to it was actually prevalent, but because, like, you know, people have that idea and then they'll go somewhere and someone will support it for them. And I think that's one of the downsides of wrestling, in that, like, you know, someone like you or I, who, you know, are obviously not someone you would consider like a stereotypical wrestling fan.
Right.
You know, have to live with the stigma of, like, you know, hiding, going to wrestling shows from coworkers and stuff like that.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. I mean, when my coworkers ask me, like, you know, on weekends when I'm going to wrestling shows, which is most weekends now, and, you know, the coworkers say, like, hey, you got any big plans this weekend? I'm like, no, not really. You know, just the usual. Like, I don't say, oh, I'm going to see wrestling.
Yeah, because, first of all, you had to tell them every weekend and they'd be horrified.
Yeah, right.
But also, you know, it is the kind of thing where, like, it's worth it to not say something just so you don't have to defend yourself.
Yeah, exactly. Right. I mean, I work at a university, like, you can... And yeah, people have this notion when they think of wrestling, and it's not totally unjustified. But there's, like you said, there's more going on. Like, if you watch if you read the Roland Barthes essay about wrestling and mythologies, that really gets at the heart of sort of what's actually sort of sophisticated and profound about wrestling. But too often, wrestling fans themselves sort of go for like this cheap crap. And a lot of times indie promoters think that's what people want. And that's one of the reasons that so many indie promotions sell like 75 tickets a show, because they just give people the lowest common denominator. Whereas promotions that try harder, like Beyond Wrestling or PWG or Evolve, do better.
Yeah, I mean, I think that that's really at the base of things, like the real truth behind it. When you have something that's kind of low brow to the lowest common denominator, it tends to fail. It tends to be not as popular as something that is more specialized for more discerning crowd, I think. And that's like what I would consider something like PWG or Evolve. Like, it's not, it's not lowbrow in the sense that you like something like XPW or something was.
Oh my God. XPW.
You know, that's, it's, I think of XPW, I think, as like the epitome of the lowest common denominator for like a wrestling promotion. It's just like full of, you know, blatant TNA and not TNA, the wrestling program, actually.
TNA.
Because
it was like actual porn stars.
Yeah, porn stars and things. And like just like all the matches involved barbed wire and blood and chair shots and table spots and whatever. It's not like, it's like if you took the worst parts of ECW and magnified it by 20.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. XPW is like, I was at this, there's a great store nearby, Ken's Cards and Collectibles, and they have this room of just wrestling stuff, and they have all these DVDs, just an astonishing amount of wrestling DVDs, and they had like all the episodes of XPW TV, because I guess they did like a brief TV show. I mean, it wasn't like on a network or anything, but it was on like syndicated, you know, shows in the LA area. And just like, it was like this horrible document of like the worst moments of wrestling in the year 2000. It was just like, why would anyone want to preserve this shit? But yeah, and like a lot of people still think that is the way to go. Or like horrible racist gimmicks or like horrible comedy skits. There's comedy wrestling done well, as we talked about when we talked about the shows we went to. And then there's just like stupid garbage.
Yeah, and I think a lot of the stuff, I mean, it sounds actually like the show that this guy in that article went to was stupid garbage.
Yeah, it does. Yeah, that's one thing too I forget. Like, living in the Northeast, I am spoiled when it comes to indie promotions. There are a lot of really good ones within easy driving distance of my house that, you know, get people from Ring of Honor and like national indies and like get all this talent because we're near New York and Boston and people are always working in this part of the country. And it's easy to forget that in a lot of the rest of the country, that is not the case. That like local wrestling is local wrestling, and sometimes it's good, and sometimes it's like that. God, we should do a review of the shows that we saw, like Imperial Wrestling Entertainment.
Oh, we should talk about those.
We should.
We should do that on another show. But some of that stuff is really interesting. I mean, it wasn't good, but it was interesting. And it was interesting enough that we wanted to watch more of it, even though it was terrible.
Yeah. Yeah, it wasn't off-putting in the way that this show in Baltimore sounds off-putting. It was just sort of like, it was kind of like compellingly bad.
Yeah. And that's, I mean, that's, I would say, better.
Yes. Oh, I agree. Yeah. Instead of something that's like both boring and offensive, something that's just kind of like so bad, it's like you want to know what's going on. Like, what were you thinking?
Yeah. There's that.
Yeah, but it wasn't like offensive. It was just sort of like, you know, not well done.
Yeah, next time we should talk about some of those like promotions like that. The ones that we watched and those kind of minor indie ones that had those like TV shows on that Roku app.
Well, that's probably all the time we have this week.
Yeah, we actually are pretty long this time.
We did. If you stuck with us all the way, thank you. And if you need more of this kind of exciting banter, you can check out my Tumblr, which is sort of where a lot of stuff from the show gets posted, closetofanxiety.tumblr.com. Joe has an excellent Tumblr. He's posting a lot more wrestling stuff on it now. Do you want to plug that?
Yeah, it's hakujinjo@tumblr.com. I'll post the link in the video description, but you know, I post some stuff on there, but Tom reposts a bunch of it. So
I do. I repost. There's a really good John Cena thing. You got to see it. It's psychedelic.
That John Cena thing is I think the most popular thing I've ever posted on a Tumblr. It's not like it's super popular or anything, but like it looks like poor art at first with John Cena in it, and then you realize and then when you start looking at it,
then you realize there's a lot more going on here.
It's then you realize there's a lot more John Cena than you thought.
Yeah, no, you got to see this. So yeah, Closet of Anxiety or Hakujinjo, there'll be links. And then on Twitter, where also there's a lot of wrestling content, I am at TJ Breen.
And I am at XCornMuffinX. And again, like if you watched the previous episodes and you, you know, and I've talked about how I never use Twitter, I've started using Twitter.
It's true. And he's getting retweeted by people like Joey Ryan now.
Yeah, I got retweeted by Joey Ryan 3 times. It's
so... He just starts using Twitter, and then like indie stars are retweeting him.
Yeah, because I'm that good at the Twitter machines, I think. But yeah, I don't use the Twitter that much, but I check it now. So if you send me a message there, it's likely that I'll get it and or see it. So there's that. And is that it? There's the YouTube channel where you're probably listening to this, unless we've somehow managed to set up the iTunes. But
at some point,
we will do that. But currently, you're only listening to this on YouTube, which is my channel. So if you want to have this sent to your YouTube channel, I guess subscribe or just come back every week. It doesn't really matter. So yeah, that's the episode. So I guess we will see you guys next time, where we're talking about probably some more indie promotions and other news and various wrestling things.
Enjoy Bound for Glory, everybody.
Yeah, Bound for Glory. Enjoy that. You can see hopefully no deaths.
That's it. Thanks for listening.
See you guys next week.